Okay, continuing with emission spectroscopy, basically correcting for background emission, okay, which is a spectral interference. Remember when we mentioned, when we say the word spectral interference, means there's some overlap between emission of something else with emission of your analyte. Okay, so that will be background spectral interference with regards emission spectroscopy. Similarly for AAS, okay, go back, because we cannot think of each of these techniques in isolation. You must always, you know, be able to compare one and the other and whatnot. Go back and forth. So when we were talking about AAS, we had the same, you can have the same problem, spectral interference. Or we did mention something about background absorption, okay? In AAS, it's absorption. So the problem was background absorption, one of the examples of a spectral interference. So their background absorption was what? Same thing here, an absorption that is due to something else other than your analyte. Okay, you just want to measure absorbance of your analyte, of your particular metal of interest. But if the absorbance readings at the detector end are due to something else other than your analyte, then that's something that you have to get rid of. Okay, that is considered background absorbance. So background absorbance there, we said one of the how you came about background absorbance is if there were particles in your flame and the red one now shows the light from the hollow cathode lamp, where there was some scattering. If there's some scattering, that means less light goes to the detector and the detector thinks it's absorbance. Because remember, absorbance is log PO over P. So P is the one that after having gone through the atoms. PO is the original one, okay? If you want to think of it simplistically. So due to scattering, PO has now been reduced, okay? So when the detector senses this reduction in P, it thinks, oh, absorbance has occurred. But actually, apart from absorbance by the atoms, there's some scattering by some molecular particles which did not vaporize 100%. If you have a lot of dissolved salts, like I said, when you have seawater, for example, you can have this occurring. Okay, so this is background absorbance, which we discussed the three methods how you overcome that. Background correction with regards AAS, by using the deuterium lamp, the continuum background correction. The Smith-Heafia, okay, running the hollow cathode at high current and low currents, second method. Third method was the Zeeman effect, okay? So three, we discussed those three basic methods of how to get rid of the background absorbance, A background. Because here, the one that you measure is A analyte plus A background. So all those three methods that we discussed just now estimated the A background so that you can minus from this total and you get only your A analyte. Okay? But one other thing about AAS also, we said that the light from the hollow cathode lamp is of two ways. Whether you can have a chopper here. So the light from the hollow cathode lamp, because of the mechanical chopper, is having a certain frequency. And we lock in, the detector locks in at this frequency, such that, what does that mean? That the detector will only sense frequency at radiation at that frequency. Light from anywhere else, it won't sense, okay? It won't detect. It won't take the readings. So that's one way of, you know, making sure that only, okay, it only senses this light that comes from the hollow cathode lamp. So let's say if there's something else in here that also emits light, at the same wavelength as that red one, the detector will not sense it. Why? Maybe you should have it in a red color also, to show that, you know, there's something else that also gives out light at a wavelength similar to the one that we are monitoring the absorbance. But it's not due to, it didn't come from the lamp. Okay, some source inside the flame. How is it that the detector, will the detector detect this light or not? Why? The light that came from emission of a particle in the flame, form in the flame. Why won't the detector detect this light? Same wavelength. You know, we can say that it's at the copper lamp, copper line, 324. So monochromator is ready to, what goes through the monochromator is 324 nanometers. Why is it that the detector will not, it will go through the monochromator, but the detector says, okay, this light coming from this particle, it will not take the reading? No, it's the same wavelength. I'm now saying that, assume that there is something in the flame that is formed and emits light at that same wavelength. That's why I said red color, same. Light from the source that we are detecting is also 324. Light from this emitted by this species is also 324. So some molecular emission, okay? Why won't the detector detect this light coming from this particle? Because for absorbance, it will detect 324 and detect how much is being absorbed. So it will detect PO first, then P, and then find the log to get the absorbance. Just when we talked about just now, at the chopper frequency, the light from the lamp will be chopped at a certain frequency. What about this light? It won't, because it's coming from the lamp. If it's coming from the flame, okay? So it won't undergo that chopping mechanism. So that's why the detector will only detect the PO. But any molecular emission, it won't detect. Because why? Even though it's the same wavelength, it is not at that frequency. Two ways, right? Whether you have the mechanical chopper or you have a pulse source. That means the source itself is pulse. So to make sure that, no, okay, the light coming out that should be detected by the detector is at a certain frequency. So the detector already locks in. So you will find this, something about this lock-in amplifier, if you, in your text or maybe some other text. That means the detector is already locked in to that frequency. Other things, it won't detect. So this overcomes partly this kind of problem. But just now, the scattering will not be overcome by this pulse source or this mechanical chopper, okay? So this is background correction with regards AAS. Now we talk about background correction emission. We'll take an example of this, for example, okay? Now, this is emission, okay? We are not thinking about this anymore. No source. Just the plasma. And we're talking about emission spectroscopy. Okay, this is what that just now was the illustration of what is meant by here. Okay, you subtract the background adjacent in the case of the tungsten, or for the sloping background is the case of the cadmium. But in both cases, the interfering element was aluminium. For sloping background emission, measure on both sides, okay? Or if there's some line overlap. Overlap means same wavelength. Or with the monochromator that you use, you cannot resolve the two lines. They're too close. And then probably you have to use another line. Choose another emission line. Okay, so this is an example of how you overcome background emission with respect to emission spectroscopy. Okay. The ones that we have looked at, the nebulae, we have shown how you introduce your sample. Sample introduction for emission so far that we've shown is liquid samples where you use a certain nebulizer. You can also have solid samples where you can have, we look at the direct insertion probe, laser ablation, that means using the laser to break up your solid or your slurry samples into vaporize and ultimately get it into the plasma. Or electrothermal, I think we've seen that. In order to get your samples into solution, sometimes most of the times you need to do some sample preparation. So you talk about digestion, digestion coming from digestion in your stomach. But now you are digesting your sample with the use of acids, or sometimes depending on the kind of samples that you have, will determine whether you want to use aqua regia. Go and find out what aqua regia means. It's a mixture of which acid. Or you need to use, if you have some silicates, you need to use HF. Fusions with some sodium hydroxide or whatever, some alkali that you have to put into your sample, okay? Or the third kind is dry ashing, which means that you ash the sample at very high temperatures so that all the organics and whatnot become CO2, and what is left is a white ash, which you then dissolve with the use of some acid. So all these sample preparation techniques are to eventually get your sample into solution, which makes it easy. You can do solid sampling, analyzing solid samples, but it becomes more difficult. The easiest is liquid samples because your standards are also in liquid form. When you do analyzing solid samples, making sure that your standards are also the same as your sample becomes a difficulty. Because you want, ideally, you want the matrix of your sample to be the same as your, or rather your standard, matrix of your standard to be the same as matrix of your sample. It becomes more difficult if you have solid samples. Well, these are some other examples, whether you need to use some organic solvents and whatnot. But of course, using organic solvents in the plasma is more of a problem compared to using it with flames. Okay, all that we have looked at is the inductively coupled plasma, ICP. Okay, there's a second kind, not so commonly used, which is the direct current plasma. Ultimately, you form the plasma, okay? The plasma is what? When I say plasma, what comes to mind? What's in the plasma? When we were talking to ICP, plasma, the argon plasma, what species were in the plasma? Atoms, what else? Ions, argon ions, electrons, you know? Those metastable species of argon, AR plus, AR star star, whatever, all kinds of, you know, all those things. So here also, yes, you will form such a plasma. The difference in the direct current plasma is how the plasma is formed. You know, in the ICP, you talk about radio frequency generator, the copper coil, okay, seeding with an electron and then forming the plasma. In the DCP, you need electrodes. In the ICP, all I showed to you was that glass torch. That's all it is. The glass torch, with the three concentric tubes, the copper coil connected to an RF frequency, and argon gas flowing through. That's it. And then you have to seed it with some electron to start the plasma. No electrodes involved, nothing. Okay, no graphite, no nothing. But with the DCP, you need electrodes. Okay, so you have two anodes made of graphite. Okay, so you have your anode block which holds the electrode. This thing is the electrode. The ceramic sleeve holds the electrode, and then you have the cathode block which has I believe it's tungsten, some kind of a third electrode. So okay, at the beginning, in order to light up the plasma, you need to have these two anodes and cathode in contact with one another. Okay, and then you have a jolt of, I'm sure, some current goes through the thing and the plasma is formed, and then the cathode will be raised and you get this inverted Y looking plasma. The ICP look like a flame, okay? But for the DCP, you will have a inverted Y plasma. And here you will have another tube which is then connected to your nebulizer or whatever. Your aerosol and your argon will enter the plasma in this from the bottom here. So the same thing will happen. It's just that, like I said, the DCP is formed in a different way. And perhaps the temperature is not as high as the ICP. At the observation area, the temperature is about 5,000 Kelvin. And you need the electrodes. And in time, those anodes will be consumed. You know, it's made up of a graphite, so it will be burnt off, and you have to replace the anodes. So much, so very different in how it runs compared to the ICP. You also have the microwave plasma. We're not going to go into that. You know, just to mention that there's the ICP, the DCP, and the microwave plasma. Besides that, we also have the. I didn't have the diagram here. You can go and look it up in the text. The glow discharge emission spectroscopy. Which is used to analyze conducting as well as non-conducting samples. Again, you need to have electrodes. And so we have a glow discharge between the electrodes and the samples. You know, in all these, whether it's the plasma or the glow discharge, in the plasma or in the discharge, you will get, you know, your sample becoming a gas, undergoing dissociation, excitation, etc. You know, the same processes, but just in different excitation sources. So now you call them excitation sources. Flame, plasma, glow discharge, DCP, microwave plasma, they are all called excitation sources because the atoms or the ions form in there ultimately has to be excited in order to emit the characteristic emission wavelength for that element, okay, for the emission spectroscopy. Next, we want to look at arc and spark. Arc and spark also comes under emission spectroscopy, and it's more ancient compared to the plasma, okay. Earlier on, you have this arc spark emission spectroscopy, where you can do with arc spark is basically to do analysis of solid samples. So even though it's a rather classical, very classical technique, it is still being used in the metal industry. Because in the metal industry, where they do metal recovery, for example, or whatever, so you have your metal, solid metal samples, which they want to analyze. they don't want to digest and change it into a solution, then only analyze the thing. So they want to do direct analysis of the metal. Okay, so arc spark spectra, emission spectroscopy is useful. Even to this day, you still get some spark emission spectroscopy, but of course, having more modern monochromators and detectors compared to when it was used many, many, many eons ago. Okay, so that's what we're going to be looking at next. More classical. This came about before you got your ICP, DCP, etc. So you can do with arc spark source spectroscopy, you can do either qualitative or quantitative, and basically, you know, for these kind of samples. Excitation now occurs between a pair of electrodes. You must have an electrode, two pairs of electrodes. And you have electricity going through the electrodes. So it goes through the gap between the two electrodes, and what will happen is the same thing. The solid sample has to become atoms, has to become ions. Okay? You cannot analyze with emission spectroscopy. You put the metal, yes, you can analyze the metal. No. That metal will have to undergo volatilization, becoming a gas. Okay? Part of that metal will have to vaporize it or not. It's not solid. Unless you do X-ray, some X-ray method, yes, the solid can be, you know, a non-destructive method. Where you have a solid, you put inside, yes, you can get the elemental analysis for that solid, and after that you can get the solid back. X-ray fluorescence, which you will do with Dr. Lim. But when you talk about whatever methods that we have talked about, AAS, etc., even though if we can do solid analysis, the solid will be destroyed. Okay? It has to become, it has to undergo all this atomization and, you know, whatever, producing the excited atoms and ions. So for this arc and spark, you need electrodes, two electrodes. One is the counter electrode, the other one will be the electrode holding the sample. So you have two electrodes and you have a high voltage going through. Okay, so when it separates, you get an arc, which I don't know how to describe it. I don't know whether you've seen movies where these people in the metal foundry. No, you don't see. I don't know what movies you watch. Never mind. Just imagine you have, I don't even have any pictures. I think you will be able to Google up some pictures of this arc spark thing. So you have, here on the bottom, you have one electrode, and on top, you have another. So between the two electrodes, you have some, like lightning, you know? Lightning between clouds. Two clouds and zzzz. Okay, same idea, yes, that's a good example. So you have like a lightning spark between the two electrodes. So where that, in that lightning spark is very high temperature. So that spark or lightning will then strike the, let's say this is the on the bottom. So you have your sample here, it will strike the sample. If lightning were to strike a tree, see what happens, it becomes like a, you know, burns, right? So similarly here, you know, that high voltage, high bolt of energy will then make your sample vaporize, volatilize, ultimately excited. In arc spark, one reason why you can do solid is the sample, if it's a nail, you can do analysis of a nail, you know, paku. Nail, so I want to do the, I want to know what are the metal components in the nail. I don't even know whether you've held a nail in your life or not. Hey, in school probably you did have to do some carpentry, right? Kemahiran hidup. If not at home, at least in school. So one of the counter electrodes is the metal, the other one is the nail. And so you will get then, you can do a qualitative analysis where maybe you can get what are the metals in your nail, or you want to do quantitative analysis. Okay, so in this case, one of the electrodes can be your sample, if your sample is conducting. If it's not conducting, then you need to have an electrode and you put your sample in there. So that's basically it for the story about the arc spark. Okay, where is it used? In the metal industry right now. You have some spark emission spectroscopy with some fancier detectors and monochromator. Okay, here is to show, remember the hydride generator? Hydride generation, for what elements did we analyze it for? AAS, hydride generation AAS. Okay, the test is Wednesday, yeah? What elements do you analyze using hydride generation? Arsenic, bismuth, selenium, okay, those elements that will form hydrides easily. Where you form, what is a hydride? What is a hydride? H-Y-D-I-R-D-E. What do you understand by the word hydride? H plus? No, H plus is what? H minus? Oh, okay, that means, but when you talk about hydrides as a compound, some formation of the hydride lah, combined with hydrogen, okay? The metal forms a compound with the H, AS, H3, AS, whatever, you know, whatever ratio of metal to hydride. So you form the hydride in a gaseous form, as we show here, okay, ICP is not shown. All here is your process of forming your hydride. So you have your sample, your acid, again, NaBH4, sodium borohydride. This is the reducing agent. So we'll go through this pump, go through the mixing T. The mixing T means it's a mixing coil. So all your sample, your reducing agent will go into this mixing coil, and the hydrides will be formed. So you separate your liquid and your gas, and your hydride is a gas. We'll go into the ICP and be broken down to the atoms, the ions, and emit and have your measure your emission. Okay, but this whole thing is another way of how you introduce your sample into the ICP, not using any nebulizer, but by hydride generation. Here is the electrothermal. Okay, you have your sample into your graphite furnace. So the function of your graphite furnace is to produce the atomic vapor, which will then go inside here and become ionized and excited. Direct insertion device. So that means maybe you have some probe, some graphite electrode which contains your sample that can be inserted into your plasma. Or just different ways of, you know, how you directly get your sample inside the plasma. Before we look at this, okay, let's go back to this. Is it further up or further down? Probably not here. Just looking at this now. I will email you this PDF file. This is a book by Perkin Elmer, you know, so on ICP OES. So I think it's a pretty good book. I mean, just to give you an overall idea about plasma. From the side or axially, axial viewing. So you have one here, here, that is radial viewing. From the end will be axial. So it can choose, depending on the supplier, maybe you can choose, okay, you want to have axial viewing or you want to have radial viewing. Where for some elements, maybe axial viewing might be better compared to radial. Or you want to have, you can't have both at the same time, I suppose. You could. Depending on, it all depends on the computer, how you control the thing. Okay. And that's basically what I have, unless you have any questions for emission spectroscopy. Anything? So we have finished emission spectroscopy, and we have focused on the ICP. I mean, commercially available, when you talk about emission, as I mentioned before, when you talk about emission spectroscopy, it's ICP. You know, arc spark, okay, spark emission spectroscopy maybe for metal industry, but flame, you don't really do flame emission. But flame photometry, like I said, for your lithium clinical analysis, they still use the flame photometer, the simple, it's flame emission, but you don't have any fancy monochromator. You have a filtering system. That's why it's called flame photometer, to do your potassium, lithium, sodium analysis, and it uses a cooler flame. You don't need to have a plasma to do your sodium. Okay. Any questions? No? Yeah, it's all it's just one kind of excitation source where it needs the electrode. You know, just imagine with the clouds, the spark between the clouds. Now you need the spark between the two electrodes. One counter electrode, one electrode holding your sample, or your sample itself. It's a conducting sample, if the sample conducts. So actually the progression in time is, it began with flame emission, arc spark, then only it progressed to plasma, okay? DCP, ICP, microwave plasma. It started with radial, and then it went on to axial. I mean, that's the progression that you have. The earlier detectors were the photo multiplier tubes, where you had that kind of, in order to do multi-elemental, you need to have many, many photo multiplier tubes. Now, to do multi-elemental, you need only that tiny semiconductor kind of detector. Whether in emission spectroscopy, two important things. Whether you do simultaneous analysis, multi-elemental has two versions, whether you do simultaneous analysis or sequential. Simultaneous instruments are, of course, more expensive compared to sequential. But sequential, because they do it at such a, you know, a short time, very rapid analysis, is almost similar to simultaneous. So, and of course, to do all this analysis, you would have to have a computer control, so that you can then set it up. Okay, I want to do A, B, K, X, and Z. Okay, and it will go from one wavelength to the other, and take the emission, take the readings. So remember now, emission, it's emission intensity, no sources, no lamps, no hollow cathode lamps. AAS, then you talk about absorbance. So please do not interchange these German terms interchangeably when you talk about different methods, okay? So okay then.